Now, it's not about us. It's about the Lord. We don't know what people go through. You have no idea. We have no clue what a lot of people go through. That's why as a church, as a ministry, the leadership in this house, y'all, when Stan said this today up here, he said, this ministry is here to what? Meet the needs of the people. Hear for one another. Praying for one another. Interceding for one another. There's not a day goes by that the pastor, the leadership here is not praying for every soul in this congregation, y'all. Every day. Whether we on vacation, didn't matter. Wherever we're at, it's every day we intercede and pray for this ministry. Every family. We need a covering, amen? And there's power in prayer. That's not my message either, y'all. This is just a different service today, amen? But you know what? God says, my house must be a house of prayer. That's why before every Sunday morning, before I ever get up to this pulpit, I'm marching around these pews, y'all. Every Sunday morning before I preach. And I'm marching around on that stage asking God to anoint our praise leaders, our praise team, our musicians. Have your way, Lord. Have your way in this service. This is your service. We're your people. But we have to bathe everything in prayer. So I encourage everybody in here. You don't have to be a leader. Pray every day for the ministry. Pray for the leadership. Pray for one another. Amen? Well, I guess I'm going to preach this. I wanted to preach about some water today, but God ain't going to let me do it, all right? So I'm going to give y'all a message that, and I'm going to have to ask the Lord to really help me because this is a tough one for me a little bit. Amen? But I really want to talk to you. Just open your Bibles to Colossians chapter 2. If you would stand on your feet, let's read this scripture. We'll pray and ask God to have his way. I'm a believer in God's word, church. Amen. His word is truth. Colossians chapter 2, verse 16 and verse 17. And we're going to try to look at something in here. Maybe God can teach us something here today. Before I go too far, before I even read this, just let me tell you this. No man knows the day or the hour that the Lord is coming back. And we're not sitting here today trying to set no day or no time or no period that the Lord has to come back. Amen. We don't do that. I have no clue when he's coming back. I just know he is. Come on, somebody. I know Jesus is coming back. And I think sometimes as a church, we forget that and we get our focus off. If we would live our lives, let me say this before I read this scripture. If we would live our lives like Jesus is coming back in the next hour or two, what do you think we would do? Is there anything in our life that would change if we knew without a doubt in the next hour Jesus was coming back? See, the Lord wants us to live our lives in an expectation of his coming back. That's the way we're to live our lives, even though we don't know the day or the hour. See, it's really not just about the Lord coming back and taking his church up, being called up, or him coming back and setting his feet down on the Mount of Olives. I said this and I'll say it again. We don't know when we're going to take our last breath. Amen. And when that happens, that's going to be a, you know, calling away for us. Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord for those who love him. Those who don't are going to a place called Hades. Amen. And waiting for another judgment of God. Great white throne judgment. But that's not what we're talking about today. Let me give you this. I want to hopefully the title of this message is this. He's coming back. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, he's coming back. Look at Colossians chapter 2. Verse 16 says this. And I know y'all wondering how in the world is he going to get coming back out of all this. But we're going to do it. I hope. Colossians 2:16 says, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or of a new moon or the Sabbath days, which are a, everybody say shadow. These things are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. Lord, I thank you right now for your goodness, your mercy, your awesome power. Fill me with the Spirit of the living God. Help me to speak your word. Use this vessel for your glory, Father, and only for your glory. Touch every heart, every mind, every soul here that we would receive your word, that we would expect you to come back, that we would be looking for you to come back. And we give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. Everybody says, amen. Let's give God a big old clap of praise while you've been seated. Great God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can be seated. This message, I really had to do some praying. I said, Lord, help me, because I want us to, first of all, let me just make a little foundation here. You should not ever let nobody judge you as to what the Word of God says about holy days, new moons, or Sabbath days, because what happens, some people get legalistic over God's feast days.
Amen.
Now, I believe in God's feast days. Got to get amen up in here. I believe God established some feast days. They're His days. He did that. Man didn't do it. He did it. But we have people sometimes who get so legalistic with feast days that they worship the feast days instead of worshiping the one who created the feast days. Somebody help me. It's like the feast days are more important than Jesus. There's not no feast day, y'all, that's more important than Jesus. Come on. And let me tell you this. And we're going to look at some stuff today, y'all. The spring feast days have already been fulfilled by Jesus.
That's right.
Come on. The three major feast days. And we're going to look at this in just a little bit. And there's other three feast days, the fall feast days, that have not yet been fulfilled. But we know they will.
Yes.
If Jesus fulfilled the spring feast days, don't you think He's going to fulfill the other ones?
Yes.
Because, and God has these things established because He's God. Can I get another amen up in here? Now, we have to be careful because the Bible says right here, a shadow. These feast days and everything God has established is a shadow of things to come. But the body is the most important. The body is the body of Jesus. That's the most important thing. Amen. It's all about Jesus. And that's where we got to stay focused even today, okay? The body of Christ, see, think about it like this. It's the body of Jesus that casts the shadow. Everything was done so that it would point people to Jesus.
Yes.
Everything God established, the feast days, everything He established was to point people to the Lord. We're on the same page. Y'all still with me? So don't get legalistic over the feast days or the new moons or the Sabbath days. We should learn from them. Everybody say learn.
Learn.
And I'm hoping that we're going to learn something up in here today. Learn their meaning. Learn what it means about this feast day that God established. Learn what's the meaning behind that. God, why did you establish that? Why did you do that? Learn from them, but don't get legalistic.
Amen.
We worship Jesus again, not the feast days. We learn that Jesus has fulfilled again the spring feast days, and He fulfilled them at His first coming. I might be teaching a little bit more than I'm preaching today, okay, but that's all right. In His first coming, how many knows about the Feast of Passover?
Amen.
It's in the book of Exodus, you read it. But it's the Passover is all about the Lamb. It's about Jesus who was sacrificed. That's what the Passover stands for, okay? Jesus fulfilled that. He is the Lamb of God. Amen. He is that sacrifice. The Feast of Unleavened Bread. That's when Jesus was buried. Do y'all realize that on Passover, the very day of Passover, Jesus became that sacrificial Lamb? On the Feast of Unleavened Bread, Jesus was buried.
Yes.
On the very same day, 2 days later, or 3 days later, guess what happened? The other feast, the Feast of First Fruits,
yes.
On the very day that the Feast of First Fruits that God established, guess what? Jesus rose from the dead. Isn't that amazing? Now see, we don't worship those feast days, but we worship the one who fulfilled those days. Amen?
Yes.
He fulfilled every one of them to a T, exactly what God had established. Now to me, that is amazing, isn't it? That someone's going to come. These feast days, when God established those, many years later, here comes the Lamb of God, here comes Jesus, and He fulfills them. And now we know, because He fulfilled those spring feast days at His first coming, when the fall feast days, and some of the Jews celebrate them today, and some people do, those feast days will be, I do believe with all my heart, will be fulfilled at His second coming. Everybody say His second coming. He's coming again. Gonna get amen. The other three, the fall feast days that we're talking about, and we're only going to talk about one today. If God allows me, we'll take up a couple more in the weeks to come. I don't know, but we're going to talk about it. I'll give you the three, and I'll tell you the one we're going to talk about. We have the Feast of Trumpets. That's number one. That's a fall feast day. We have Yom Kippur. That's number two. And then we got the Feast of Tabernacles. And all of them are coming up. In fact, today what we're going to talk about is the Feast of Trumpets. And guess when the Feast of Trumpets is? This coming Friday, September the 13th, 2015. I mean, I said Friday, I'm sorry. Sunday, I meant Sunday. Where did I get Friday from? Good Friday, I don't know. So the feast day, the Feast of Trumpets, will be this Sunday. We'll be having church, hallelujah. Ain't that awesome? But it'll be this Sunday, the 13th. So I guess we got to ask ourselves, what is the Feast of Trumpets? I mean, and see, we can't set a time. We're not doing that. Please don't take this the wrong way. But we do know Jesus is coming back. We do know he'll fulfill his feast days. Amen. But we don't know the day. We don't know the hour. We don't know if that'll be, if this coming Sunday could be a, God could call his people up, or he could actually come down and put his feet on the Mount of Olives. We're going to look at some stuff today, and I want to get you to thinking, okay? See, I believe and I know the reason God gives us these feast days, and they're in the Bible, is for us to look for his coming, to expect him to come back. He's given us signs. Y'all, there's so many signs we're getting right now in the heavens. Everybody's talking about the blood moons, the last blood moon to happen. There's been four blood moons. The last one to happen is going to be this year. Can I get amen up in here? And it's coming up to September the 28th. Will be a blood moon, which is happens to be on the Feast of Tabernacles. God lets us, we'll talk about that, but right now I want to look at this Feast of Trumpets, okay? The Feast of Trumpets, or it's also called Rosh Hashanah. Maybe y'all, a lot of y'all heard that. It's called Rosh Hashanah. It's when Jesus comes back and he gathers his people to himself. Now, some people believe this could be the rapture, or this could be the time where Jesus actually comes back and sets his feet on the Mount of Olives. Whatever, this is a feast that God has established. Now, I want you to look at this. We're going to look at some stuff today. This is also a day, y'all. See, you can't put God in a box. You've got to say you've got to do this. Because this is also a day that the Jewish, this is the Jewish, this coming Sunday, the 13th, is the Jewish New Year. It's their New Year. We start ours on January. They start theirs on Tarish 1, okay? Which is right here. It'll be September the 13th. Now, I could get into some stuff they teach, but I don't want to get into a whole lot of that, but even in the Jewish culture, because we miss so much a lot of times, but even in the Jewish culture, they say this is when God evaluates the people. He looks at their lives, because there's 10 days, and then you got the Yom Kippur, but we'll talk about that later, not today, but some other time. I don't want to get y'all too confused, but it's like God looks at everybody's lives and says, seeing what they have done for him, whether they've done some good deeds or bad deeds or whatever, and he begins to, if they've been good and done some good deeds for him, serving the Lord, they sort of take it, he says, this is what the Jews teach now, that they take their name and write it in the Lamb's Book of Life, because they've been doing good deeds for the Father. Now, I'm not getting into that. I'm just telling you a little bit of Jewish tradition, okay, to say about that. But what I want to tell you, it is a day. This is the day of the new year for the Jewish people. It's also a day of judgment, amen, where God judges his people. It is also a day of remembrance. God remembers what people have done for him. The Jews believe it's the birthday of the world, when God created the world. This is September 13th this year, okay? They believe that this is the day that Adam and Eve were created. They believe that the flood waters were dried up on this day, on the Feast of Trumpets. They also believe that on the Feast of Trumpets, when Enoch was taken up. Isn't that amazing, y'all? Y'all remember the story of Enoch? He was translated and taken up to heaven. They believe it was on that day, this day, Feast of Trumpets. They believe that this was the day that Joseph was freed from prison. And the slavery of the Jews in Egypt ended on the Feast of Trumpets. It was on the Feast of Trumpets, at the sound of the trumpet, that God, I will tell you this, on the very day, the Feast of Trumpets is the very day that God came down on Mount Sinai to meet his people. Isn't that amazing? Let's look at that in Exodus. Y'all want to show you something in Exodus. If you look at Exodus chapter 19, well, this is a different kind of message. I must be listening, all right? Yeah, I got. Now, remember, on the Feast of Trumpets, y'all, this is amazing, because the Bible is just so full of knowledge and wisdom, and God don't do things just to be doing them. God does have times appointed that he does things. Amen. There was a time appointed for Jesus to be born, and he was born on that very day. But look at Exodus chapter 19. Look at verse 16. It came to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunders and lightnings, a thick cloud upon the mount. The voice of the trumpet. There's the trumpet, y'all. Exceeding loud. All the people that were in the camp trembled. This was a supernatural trumpet, by the way, coming from heaven. This ain't no man blowing a trumpet, okay? This is a supernatural trumpet that's being blown. It's coming from heaven. Moses brought forth the people out of the camp to meet what? To meet with God. This is on the Feast of Tabernacles, on the Feast of Trumpets, y'all. And they stood at the nether part of the mount. And Mount Sinai was altogether on a smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. And the smoke there ascended as the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mount greatly quaked. Isn't this amazing, y'all? And when the voice, here it is, when the voice of the trumpet sounded long, I mean, it just continued. It waxed longer and louder. Moses spoke, and God answered him by a voice. And the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mount. And the Lord called Moses up to the top of the mount, and Moses went up. Do you see that? God came down, Moses went up. Good Lord. Ooh, hallelujah. I think about that sometimes. The Lord's coming down one day. Guess what? We're going up. Gonna get amen. Hallelujah. It's the same thing on the Mount of Sinai. God came down, Moses went up. One day the Lord's coming back, y'all. When he comes back, guess what? He's gonna come back, he's coming back, he's coming back, he's getting there, and then all of a sudden we're gonna be caught up to be with the Lord in the air. Amen. We're talking about the Feast of Trumpets, y'all. There'll be a day for God's people that we shall all be changed, y'all. It's a mystery. It's a new revelation. It's given by the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 and 52 says this: Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the what? At the last trump, when the trumpet sounds. Good Lord. When that trumpet sounds, the Bible says, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. There's coming a time, y'all, there's going to be a trumpet sound. Could it be this Friday? Could it be this Sunday? I don't know. It could be. Praise God if it would. Amen. Wouldn't you like to go to heaven? Amen. Come on. Ain't that what we, don't we all want to go to heaven? We always say, wait a minute, Lord, I ain't ready to go. I'm having too much fun. I'm doing too much stuff. God is wanting us to expect His coming, y'all. Good Lord, He probably won't come this Sunday, okay? We probably won't be raptured, but guess what? We need to expect Him to come back. We need to get our eyes open, get our eyes off of this world, get our eyes off of this mess we got our eyes on, and get our eyes on the Lord. He is coming back. I don't know when. I don't have a clue when, but I know He's coming back. And I know it's going to be in a moment. In the twinkling of an eye. Before you can take a spoon and you stick it in that grapefruit and that juice comes popping in your eye. Before you can close your eyes, before that grape juice gets in your eye, He's coming back that quick. That's fast, isn't it? When He comes back, y'all, there ain't no devil in hell gonna stop it. There ain't nobody here gonna stop you from going to meet Him. Come on. And I know a lot of people have a hard time with the rapture because rapture ain't mentioned in the Bible, but we are gonna be caught up. And everybody's arguing, well, is it gonna be before the tribulation, in the middle, or at the end? Why are we even worried about that? Why are we even fighting over that? Why are we even fighting if it's gonna be in the beginning, in the middle, or the end? We don't need to fight about that. It don't matter. We just got to know that the Lord is coming back. Yes. And we're living in the latter days. Amen. People don't want to believe that. People said, I've heard that all my life. But what we do not understand is when Israel became a nation in 1948, God's time clock started. Yes, it did. It started, y'all. And that generation that has seen Israel become a nation will not perish. That generation are going to see these things fulfilled. Somebody help me up in here. Amen. It's going to happen. We're living in those days, and it's not the church is asleep. We don't care. We just don't want to believe nothing. We want to do our own thing, to go about our own lives. And it's time for us to wake up. Like Gene said, it's time to grow up. It's time. If I was expecting the Lord to come, I'm coming even this say this Sunday, what would change in my life? What would I be doing different? See, when we're expecting the Lord to come back, there's a lot of things we just wouldn't do. Somebody help me up in here. Because we'd be so consumed. Lord, I know you're coming back.
Yes.
I don't know the day or hour, but I know you're coming. And I want to be ready. I want to be serving you. I want to be pleasing you. 1 Thessalonians 4, 15 through 18 says this. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. This is not the word of man, it's the word of the Lord. This is what God has said. This is what God has spoken. He says the Lord himself, Jesus himself, not an angel, not nobody else. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven.
Amen.
Good Lord, how many realize that Jesus right now is sitting by the right hand of the Father?
Yes.
How many realize one day he's going to get up? Yeah, we believe in the Father. He's sitting on the throne. We believe Jesus is sitting right beside him. One day, Jesus is going to get up. The Father's going to say, son, it's time. Woo, good Lord. Son, it's time for you to get up. Woo, good Lord. He's going to get up. Look at this. He's going to stand up. He's going to get up. He's going to descend from heaven. He's going to do it with a shout. He's going to do it with the voice of the archangel. With, here it is, the trump of God. The trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air.
Glory.
To meet him where?
Glory.
In where?
In
some people don't believe in getting being caught up. But good Lord, you got to get up off of something. You got to get up in the air. He says he's going to meet you in the air. Not right here on this earth, in the air. When he comes back, you're going to be swooped up off of this thing. Good Lord. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we was all up in here together and Jesus said, oh, living branch, it's time to take y'all to heaven. Hallelujah. I'm getting up from the right side of the Father. I'm coming right down here. Good Lord. Can't you just say? And he said, come on up. Come up hither. He's going to descend. We're going to be caught up. I know there's not a whole lot of people preaching this right now because we're having too much fun. We in that kingdom now. It's the kingdom now. Y'all, if it's the kingdom now, why are we praying, Lord, your kingdom come? Why did Jesus tell his people to pray, thy kingdom come? You got too many people right now think they're living in the kingdom now, doing this stuff, doing that stuff. They think the church is going to save the whole world. Let me tell you, the church ain't going to save the whole world. It ain't going to happen. We're going to be that witness, that testimony that God wants us to be. But it's going to be Jesus when he comes back who straightens out this world. The church can't straighten out the world. Guess what? The Jews couldn't straighten out the world. Even the Jewish people that God called, that nation he called, didn't straighten out the world. Now the church hadn't straightened out the world, but there's one coming who's going to straighten out the world. Hallelujah. There's one coming who's going to put down all unrighteousness. There's one coming that's going to defeat sin. Hallelujah. There's one coming that there'll be sin no more. Hallelujah. There's one coming that's going to set his kingdom up on this earth, and his name is Jesus. He is the Messiah. And before he comes back to set his feet on this earth, sometime during that period of time, I don't know when, we're going to be called up to be with him in the air. Everybody who is saved and born again and cleansed by the blood. I don't care when. I'm so tired of people arguing over when. Don't worry about when. Just know he's going to do it. Just know he's going to come back and with a shout. The Bible even says in verse 17, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. A lot of people, I've heard them say, well, it says to meet them in the clouds. That's talking about a cloud of witnesses. And I say, well, what's the air? Is that the hot air they're speaking out of their mouth or what? See, people twist the word of God. There's going to be a catching away, y'all. There's going to be a gathering up according to God's word. Not my word. God's word. What does your Bible say? God said, it says we'll be called up to be with the Lord in the air. And then it says, so shall we ever.
Be with the Lord.
Ooh, hallelujah. So shall we ever. Aren't y'all glad that, when God takes you home, that this battle we're fighting now, Come on, because we're all fighting a battle now. We're all facing the enemy. We're all fighting things. We're all striving to serve God and do what God has called us to do. But aren't you glad that when God calls you home, you won't have to fight that battle no more? That battle will be gone. You won't have to worry about God casting you out of heaven. He said you're going to be there forever. Y'all, I can't even hardly grasp hold of that forever thing. Because we're so used to time here. We're so used to seasons here. We're so used to one season ending and another one starting. There's seasons in all of our lives. I had a season, come on. We got some seasons starting, praise God. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Seasons in our lives, y'all, where things change. There was a season in my life where I didn't know the Lord. There was a season in my life where I was not even serving the Lord. But then there comes a season now, praise God, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, that I'm serving the Lord, that I know the Lord. We have a relationship with the Lord. There's seasons when it rains, y'all, and there's seasons when it's dry. But guess what? Jesus is still there in the rain, or whether it's dry, wherever. He's still there. But there's seasons, and we're used to seasons here. There's coming a time, y'all, praise God, hallelujah, we don't have to worry about one season in and another one starting, because we're going to be with the Lord forever, for all eternity. We're going to be ruling and reigning with the Lord. What an awesome time that's going to be. Then he says this. He says, why don't you, in verse 18, comfort one another with these words? Why is it nobody wants to talk about the Lord coming back? He says, comfort one another. Know what you're going through is just for a season. Don't you quit. Don't you give up. Don't you let the devil win that battle. You take a stand. Persevere. Trust me. I'm coming back. I'm taking you home. See, a lot of people want to stop serving the Lord or don't want to do what God wants them to do because, well, he's delayed his coming. He's not come back when I expected him to. My daddy preached it. My grandpa preached it. My grandpa's grandpa preached it. They've been preaching it. He's not coming back. What makes you think he's going to come back now? You know, that's a dangerous thing. It's dangerous, y'all, when we don't teach the people to look for the coming of the Lord. It's dangerous when we don't tell everybody to get ready. Keep your house in order. Don't let nothing come in. Keep your house in order. Keep serving the Lord. It's dangerous when people say, he ain't coming back no time soon. See, there was 10 virgins the Bible talks about. All had the same message. All were waiting for the bridegroom to come. 5 of them got foolish because they said, he's delaying his coming. Who knows when he's going to come? He didn't come when I thought he was. Good Lord. So these 5 foolish virgins, y'all, because they did not believe that it was coming back, they was not ready when he did. They didn't have no oil in their lamps. Oil representing the Spirit of the living God. Didn't have no oil. Didn't have the Spirit of God. Come on. And when the Lord come back, guess what? The 5 foolish did not get to enter in with the Lord into the kingdom. Only those that were looking for him. Don't y'all think it's important for us to look for him? Thank you, Carolyn. Hallelujah. It's important, y'all, for us to look for the coming of the Lord. Keep that first inside. Oh, good Lord, you might be coming back today. You might be coming back tomorrow. You might be coming back Sunday. Hallelujah. Lord, you might be coming back for me this evening. Praise the name of Jesus. Why are we scared to say that? Or do we want to go to heaven or not? Good Lord. Somebody else. Why do we want no one to say, I want to stay here? No. Good Lord, y'all, this ain't our home. Heaven is your home. Golly, my Lord, y'all. Woo. Heaven is our home. Praise God. You go to the book of Revelation. I got to go there. I can't help it. Let's go to the book of Revelation a little bit. Let me show you something in here. The 7th angel. Now, I could really get into something here, and I'm not going to do that. But I could take you through all these trumpets that God is blowing, okay, in the book of Revelation. We're not going to do that. But I do want to show you this in the 7th angel. There were 7 angels. We get into the 7th angel in Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. Verse 15 says, the 7th angel sounded. He sounded his trumpet. He blew the trumpet. And there were great voices in heaven saying this, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. See, a lot of people don't believe Jesus is going to set his kingdom up on this earth. Let me tell you, he is. It's plain as day in the book of Revelation. He is going to set his kingdom up on this earth. When that seventh angel blows that trumpet, the kingdoms of this world are going to become the kingdoms of God. And the 24 elders which are sat before God on their seats are going to fall down on their faces and worship God. They're going to say this, we give you thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which was and are to come, because you have taken to yourself your great power and have reigned. And guess what? The nations were angry because your wrath has come. The nations are angry because God's wrath is fixing to be poured out. People get angry when you talk about God's wrath being poured out, but let me tell you, he's going to pour his wrath out. He's done everything he could. He sent his only begotten Son. He said, whosoever shall believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You can be saved. You can be born again. He's did everything he's going to do. He even let Jesus, his only begotten Son, die on the cross. Let him shed his blood so that you and I could be saved in this world. Whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. Whosoever will call upon his name shall be saved. God's did everything he could possibly do. When people say, I don't want it, I don't want no part of it, I'm going to live my life the way I want to, I'm going to do my will and not worry about God's will, there's coming a time where God will pour out his wrath on every soul, every vessel who will not accept the Lord. Only hope of salvation, y'all. The only Lamb of God, the only way a man can be saved through Jesus. He says, the nations are angry, your wrath is come. The time of the dead that they should be judged, that you should give reward unto your servants, the prophets, and to the saints, and to them who fear your name, small and great, and should destroy them which destroy the earth. The Bible says the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament. Good Lord, the ark of the covenant. Indiana Jones always be looking for that Ark of the Covenant. He don't know it's in heaven, does he? That's just a replica he's found, y'all. He didn't really find the real thing. Can I get amen up in here? Indiana Jones, they'd be portraying that thing, opening the lid on that thing, and all these people be getting killed. Let me tell you, that Ark of the Covenant's in heaven, eh? According to God's word, hallelujah, in Revelation. He said, and there was seen in his temple the ark of his testament. And there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and earthquake and great hail. Y'all, God is coming back. And we need to be looking for him. We need to keep our eyes on Jesus. Because when he comes back, a lot of this world's not even going to realize. They ain't going to know what's happening. And then God begins to pour out his wrath. See, we don't teach that today because it's not real popular. Oh, God, y'all always preaching God's a loving God. What do you mean he's going to pour out his wrath? God's a loving God. He's a just God. He judges justly. He's made a way for sinners, y'all, to be forgiven. Because every one of us in here, we've sinned and fallen short of God's glory. And we deserve God's wrath. Let me tell y'all something. Everybody in here, I don't care who you are, we all deserve God's wrath. But Jesus said, I'm going to take my Father's wrath upon myself. And I'm going to nail it to the cross. I'm going to take it so that you can be saved and born again through him, through Jesus. Aren't you glad about that? Praise God. I thank God for that. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm fixing to end up. Y'all, hold on a minute. Revelation 22, 12 and 13 says this. This is what I want to leave you with, y'all. Jesus said this. He says, behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me, to give every man according to his work shall be. See, a lot of people think that it don't matter about working for the Lord. It don't matter, I'm saved, I'm born again, I'm going to heaven. God has a reward for everybody who serves him, for everybody who works for him. Good Lord, who wants to go to heaven and have a little bit of your thimble he's going to put on your head and you have to lay a little thimble at his feet? Don't you want a big crown? Don't you want God to put a big old crown on your head, friend? And then you take that crown right there and you just lay it down at the feet of Jesus. Good Lord, y'all. I don't want a little thimble. I said, Lord, I was saved born again. It won't do nothing else. I saved as up by fire. And he puts a little thimble on your head in front of everybody. Good Lord. It's a little thimble like a crown. Come on. And you take that little thing, you just nail it down, you put it down at his feet. Wouldn't you love to have some crowns, y'all, with jewels in it? We talked about that crown that Jesus wore. It's got a lot of rings around. Each one of those rings are crowns, come on, and jewels in it. Wouldn't you like to have that crown on your head? And God put, and the Lord puts it on your head so that you can present that crown to him, because you realize, Lord, it was all by your grace and your mercy. I just said, here I am, Lord, use me. Use me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Y'all, I pray every day, Lord, help me to do what you want me to do today. I'm not even dependent on myself no more, friend. I'm going to do it. I'm stepping out in faith, and I'm praying, Lord, help me today. Help me to be that witness. Help me to be that testimony. Help me to give a good word to Roy. Come on, y'all. Help me. I found out Roy's feet were hurting today. You know what I did, y'all? I went over there, bowed down, and just began to pray for his feet, that God would touch his feet, to heal his feet. Come on, y'all. You see what I'm saying? Just doing things. I said, Lord, help me to do that. I guess I had a choice. I didn't have to do that. Some of you had me up in here. I didn't have to come over here, bow down, and pray for Roy's feet. But Lord, thank you for allowing that opportunity and me just being obedient and doing that. Not that they're even healed, or maybe they still hurt, but it don't matter. That's not the principle. That's not that ain't what it's about. The thing is, we do it. We come on, y'all. We meet the needs, that we just do it. Whether God heals or not, that's up to him. Whatever God does, but we do what God, we feel like God would have us to do. It's like my sister said, it ain't about me, it's about him. It's all about the Lord. You're going to be rewarded for every little drink you give to a prophet. Everything you do for God's people, you're going to receive a reward for that.
Right.
Everything.
Right.
God keeps good records. He writes it all down. It's not about us, it's about others. He says, I'm going to give to every man according as his work shall be. Then he says, I'm Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I'm telling y'all, he's coming back. Look for his coming.
Amen.
He set up these feast days to remind his people that I'm coming back.
Amen.
You've seen what I did on the spring feast days. Every one of them were filled to a T. He fulfilled them. I promise you, he will fulfill these fall feast days also. The Feast of Trumpets, Yom Kippur, which is coming 10 days after, and the Feast of Tabernacles, which starts September the 28th on a blood moon, which is not a good sign for Israel. We're not going to talk about that day there right now, but that's another message if God allows me to speak that. But y'all, I think we need to get ready. I think we need to get our house in order. I think we need to keep our eyes on the Lord. I think we need to realize and know that one day he is coming back. We don't know the day. We don't know the hour. But we know without a doubt he is coming back. See, the Feast of Trumpets is really on 2 days. That's why he says that. They have to go by the full moon. And they don't even know what the full moon is a lot of times. So they celebrate it. The Feast of Trumpets. Isn't that amazing? That's one feast that you celebrate for 2 days instead of one. Because they're not real sure what day it is. Isn't that amazing? No man knows the day or the hour. But I believe we're getting close, church.
Yes.
He's coming back. How many is ready to go home? Y'all stand on your feet. Let's give God some praise now. Come on. Come on, y'all give God a big old clap of praise. Praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God, praise God.